So now it is my pleasure to introduce today's presenter, Professor Tsu-Jae King Liu. Received her PhD in electrical engineering from Stanford University and spent 4 years after that on the staff at the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center in Palo Alto. In 1996, she joined the faculty of the University of California at Berkeley in my home department, where she's currently the TSMC Distinguished Professor in Microelectronics and the chair of the Department of Electrical Engineering and Computer Sciences. Now, many people told me that introducing Tsu-Jae is actually not necessary because she needs no introduction. Nevertheless, I would like to mention a few things. Tsu-Jae has a very well-decorated and very well-deservedly decorated career. She has received research awards, including the DARPA Significant Technical Achievement Award in 2000. This is for the development of the FinFET. And those of you who follow Moore's laws and microelectronics realize that that development is what allowed the Moore's law to continue in the last 3 to 3 years or so. She has received the IEEE Kiyo Tomiyasu Award in 2010 for contributions to nanoscale MOS transistors, memory devices, and MEMS devices, and the Semiconductor Industry Association Outstanding Research Award in 2014. Her research activities are presently in advanced materials, process technologies, and devices for energy efficient electronics, and we'll hear some of that today. Thank you, Tsu-Jae.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Francis, for that kind introduction. It's my pleasure to come speak with you today at the seminar hosted by the Center for Information Technology Research in the Interest of Society. So I think we all know that information technology has really revolutionized the way we live, work, and play. And I think as we see the emergence of the Internet of Things, there are some technological challenges for continued information technology advancement. And I think mechanical computing potentially can help us overcome some of those challenges. So hopefully by the end of the presentation today, you'll agree with me. Oh, and this background image is an image of a Babbage engine. I don't know if any of you have visited the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, but this thing weighs many tons and is actually operated with mechanical energy to perform computations mechanically. So that is not the kind of mechanical computing that I'm proposing. The kind I'm proposing is computing with the mechanical devices that are electrically actuated, okay? Just like transistors today are electronically activated. So here is a chart showing the history of electrically activated mechanical computing, or relays. And so in 1941, probably most of us were not here at that time, but history tells us that there was this computer that was built, designed by a person with the last name Zeus, Z3. It was built and it had, it was the first digital electronic computer. And it comprised about 2,000 relays, and it operated at a clock frequency of less than 10 hertz, consumed 4 kilowatts, and weighed over about a ton. Okay, but it was used, it was designed by people in Germany to perform complex analysis for design of aircraft. Now, a little bit after that, in the United States, in New York, a person by the last name of Simon came up with an idea of a personal computer. So the very first personal computer was actually a mechanical device. At that time, it cost about $600, a little bit too expensive for the average person to afford. So between 1950 and today, there is a big gap, okay? Not too many mechanical computers built between then. And so, you know, I don't know if people realize why, but it's probably because of vacuum tubes, but then, of course, the transistor, right? So in the decades since, you know, more than 50 years since, transistor was invented, integrated circuits were invented. So a lot of progress in computing devices was made with transistors. But transistors have some limitations, and I'll talk about that in a little while. And so for that reason, within the last decade or so, there have been some researchers have been re-examining mechanical computing devices built with relays, except now relay integrated circuits. So a group led by myself here at Berkeley, we actually made some progress in demonstrating relay-based circuits, and we actually built a chip that had over 12,000 relays for a simple microcontroller. And what we've been doing in recent years is focusing on scaling down the size of these relays so we can fit more and more of them on a single die, just like transistors have been scaled down to fit more and more of them on a single die. So when I last gave a seminar here in the same forum, it was in 2009. That's when we just started to make some logic circuits with relays. And so today, in my talk, I will just give you an update on what has happened since then in the last 6 or 7 years. Okay, so Professor Spanos mentioned Moore's Law. That's really the that sets the pace of integrated circuit technology advancement. So what it says is that roughly every couple of years, now it's about every 3 years, we see that technology advances, so we can fit more and more transistors on a single chip. That means these chips are more functional. It actually, so they have higher performance, and then the actual cost per function has gone down. And this has allowed designers to design more capable electronic devices. People buy them, and companies make money, a profit. They invest part of that profit to further advance the technology, and this virtuous cycle has gone on for the last few decades. So if we look, another way of looking at the impact of Moore's Law is to look at the number of computing devices that have been produced in the world over time. And so over time, you can see that the number of computing devices has grown exponentially as a result of Moore's Law. And so today we're living in the age of the mobile internet where these, let's say your smartphone does much more than computing, right? It has a lot more functionality. And that functionality is due to increasing integration of the relatively simple devices onto a single substrate. So bottom line is Moore's Law is all about increasing functionality for a given cost. Now, research at the university has to look forward. When we developed the FinFET, which Costas mentioned, it took more than a dozen years for the industry to put the FinFET into production. So today, we should be looking at technologies that will be needed more than 10 years away. And so if we extrapolate, we know that in the future, there'll be hundreds of billions of devices in the world, approaching trillions of devices. And we see that now, so the vision of the Internet of Things coming into view. So this is a chart that has been used for many years now by Professor Rabai here at Berkeley. But it shows the vision that in the future, of course, we're still going to have increased capability in the data centers, right? So cloud computing will always will continue to grow in terms of our reliance on it. The devices that we interact with directly will communicate wirelessly and access information through the cloud. But if we envision trillions of devices in the world someday, clearly that's many more devices than there will be people in the world. So then, naturally, we would expect those devices to be pretty much just distributed in our environment or in us. Right? So there'll be hundreds, if not thousands, of electronic devices per person eventually someday on this planet. So what can we do with all these devices? Well, we envision that a large part of their tasks will be just to help monitor the environment, right? So that we will see the emergence of ambient intelligence. So these devices will be sensing and monitoring, maybe communicating information about our local environment to a central control system so that electronic information systems in the future can react to the environment. So examples of applications of such societal scale information systems are the smart grid, monitoring the energy usage and distribution, especially as we incorporate renewable energy sources. In the building, we have lots of research here at Berkeley looking at smart buildings or software-defined buildings where you have sensors embedded in the buildings to monitor occupancy, the temperature, the lighting, to adjust it dynamically to the usage. In the Bay Area, we see worse and worse traffic. It'd be nice to have, of course, self-driving cars, but these have to sense the environment to make sure that not only the roads and bridges are safe, but that, you know, that traffic accidents don't happen. So we can mitigate traffic. That saves a lot of time, energy, and less pollution. And finally, you know, we do have earthquakes and other natural disasters. It'd be nice to be able to monitor the structural integrity of buildings, bridges, and roadways to keep our society safe. So a key requirement, technological requirement, for realizing this vision is that we need to have these swarms of electronic devices to be very energy efficient. So when we ask people, what is one feature that you'd like to see improved in your smartphone? Usually people say, well, we wish the battery life would be longer. Right? So even for our smartphones, which we can plug in every day, you know, we'd like to see longer battery life. That means more energy efficient usage of the battery. Imagine in the future you have hundreds or thousands of devices per person. We're not going to be able to change the batteries or plug every single one of them in. It's not going to be enough electricity. So this is the main challenge for realizing this vision of the future, is to somehow improve the energy efficiency of electronic devices. And we're talking about by orders of magnitude. We're not talking about a factor of two or three. It's orders of magnitude, by maybe 100 times, 1,000 times. OK, so the outline of the rest of my talk is to explain why our current integrated circuit devices have a fundamental limit in how energy efficient they can be. And that will set the stage for revisiting mechanical computing. And I'll talk about progress we've made in making mechanical computing devices, and actually I think a near-term application for mechanical devices that are integrated with transistors would be for storing information, sort of memory. And I'll conclude with a summary. So because this is an interdisciplinary forum, I'm not presuming that you all are experts in integrated circuit devices and technology, so bear with me. I'm just going to take a few minutes to review the basics of complementary metal oxide semiconductor integrated circuits. So here is a cartoon image of a transistor. A transistor is just an electronic switch, and today there are billions, maybe up to 10 billion transistors on a single chip. The function of a transistor is very simple. It should be an electronic switch that conducts current between two terminals, the source and drain. Okay, so these conductive regions of the semiconductor are separated by this non-conductive region, and only when you apply a suitable voltage to a control electrode, the gate, will current be allowed to flow between the source and drain. So a MOSFET, a MOS field effect transistor, or MOSFET for short, is this ideally an electronic switch. And there's two flavors of MOSFETs, N-channel and P-channel. The N-channel just means that there's negative charge in the channel in this region between the source and drain when it's on. That's where N comes from. Now, to turn on an N MOSFET, you have to put positive voltage on the gate relative to the source to attract the negative carriers, right? So opposites attract. Whereas for a P-channel MOSFET, when it's on, you have positive carriers in the channel. So you need to put a negative voltage on the gate to attract those positive carriers relative to the source. So basically, these two devices, if you hook them up in series like this between a supply voltage for your integrated circuit and ground, you can see here in this chart we have an N-channel device. So let's say the input voltage, Vin, is zero. That means this device, the gate voltage is the same as the source voltage. So this device is off. But if the input is zero, then that means this voltage here on the gate is more negative than this voltage on the source, which is at the supply positive voltage. So there's a negative voltage on the gate relative to the source. So this P-channel device is on. So basically, the output of the circuit connects to the supply voltage. So this is why for zero input voltage, you have a high output voltage. Okay? So you can encode this as a zero input and a binary logic one, okay, for the output. Now, if we actually apply a large voltage to the input, then now you have a voltage difference between the gate and the source for the N-channel device, so that turns on. And the input voltage here is the same as the source voltage, so there's no voltage here to turn on the PMOS. So basically what happens is the N-channel device turns on to connect the output to ground, so the output goes down to zero when you have a high voltage on the input. So this is an inverter. If the input is high, the output will be low. If the input is low, the output will be high. Okay, and this is the simple inverter symbol. Now, we can perform more interesting logical functions by connecting P-channel devices or P-MOSFETs in parallel like this, and N-channel devices in series like this. So this is a logical function called NAND. So the output is only going to be equal to zero if both the inputs are high. Okay, so in other words, if both inputs are high, then both transistors are on to connect it to ground. Otherwise, at least one of these P-channel devices is on, because at least one of the inputs is low, to connect the output to high. So relatively simple. The point of the function of a transistor is just connect the output to the power supply or to ground. Okay? And a memory cell, if you want to store information, you can connect two inverters like this in sort of a chain like this. So one side is at low voltage, the other side at high voltage. Or another stable configuration is, you know, the left side at one high voltage, right side at low voltage. And you can access the information stored here through these transistors that to act as switches to connect to bit lines to read out or to write in information under the control of these access transistors, which are controlled by a word line voltage. Okay, so that's the basics of CMOS. So if we look at the amount of energy needed to operate any CMOS digital logic circuit, you'll see that there's a trade-off. Looking at the energy required to perform an operation as a function of the delay, or how much time it takes to perform the operation. Okay, so if you look at the blue curve, this shows a fundamental trade-off between the energy and delay. If you'd like to save the energy, like operate at lower energy or higher energy efficiency, you have to operate at lower speed. But you can counteract this by having, since you have so many transistors on chip, you can just have multiple cores, multiple processors operating in parallel. So overall, the chip is operating at some reasonable throughput, but overall, each core is operating at a lower voltage and better energy efficiency. So this is so-called parallelism, and that's what's employed in the most advanced computer chips today. You have dual core, quad core, you know, many core graphics processor chips. So this works fine until you lower the energy per operation down to be in this regime where it bottoms out. So fundamentally, if you look at the energy delay trade-off for CMOS, you can further improve energy efficiency only to a certain point. Now beyond that point, it doesn't make any more sense to use parallelism because, you can add more parallel processors, but that's going to require more power to perform the function. Okay, so basically, this is the fundamental issue for CMOS that researchers today should be trying to find a solution to. Okay, so in the future, we know at some point parallelism will not help. And so therefore, we need to look for alternatives to the transistor as a logic switch. Okay, so let me explain why. Any kind of digital logic circuit can be, in terms of energy versus delay performance, can be understood by looking at the energy delay trade-off for a circuit like this that serves as a proxy for any digital logic circuit. So this is, let's say, some data latches here. Okay, they just latch the data so it doesn't change. But in between, when you change the input data here, inputs data string, you know, ones and zeros, you provide them to inputs of many logic gates, and then the outputs of those logic gates drive the inputs of the next stage of logic gates and so on. So typically, for a complex digital logic function, we have dozens of stages. Okay, so basically the input becomes valid, and then after one gate delay, the output becomes valid, and then you basically propagate the valid signal down the chain. So the frequency at which you can latch the data, that's the clock speed of your processor, is going to be limited by the delay of the combinational logic across between clock registers. Okay? And at any point in time, only one stage is switching. All the other stages are just waiting for their turn to switch. Okay? So that means that they're static. Okay? All right, so if we look at the energy versus delay trade-off, as I showed before, what happens is we can lower the supply voltage. So we can lower the voltage applied across the inverter, and that reduces the amount of energy needed to charge and discharge each node of this circuit. So we can reduce the supply voltage to reduce this active energy. Okay, so it depends on the fan out, depends on the logic depth and the activity factor. But anyway, bottom line is, you know, the capacitance of the circuit times the operating voltage squared. So this is what the industry has been able to do. And so the active energy we can lower by lowering this operating voltage. But if we lower the operating voltage, that means the current, ion, the on-state current of a transistor, decreases because you don't have as much voltage applied. So that means it'll take longer to charge up or discharge the capacitors in your circuit. So there will be a longer delay, so it'll take longer for this circuit to perform its function. And for that longer delay, all those stages that are not switching, they're basically leaking current, because if a transistor, I should put it on. Okay, so in this basic CMOS circuit, sorry, I forgot to mention this. Okay, a transistor is not ideal. When it's off, it's actually still leaking some non-zero current. So let's say in this configuration, if the P-channel device is leaking, you're going to have this current flowing between supply voltage and ground. Right? So a transistor, if it's non-ideal, is going to waste power even when the circuit is not switching. Right? That's the static power. Okay, so that's the I off times VDD power consumption. And the total energy consumed is you have to multiply by the time it takes to perform the function. Okay, so fundamentally, that is the reason. Eventually, if you lower the supply voltage too much, you will no longer improve the energy efficiency of your CMOS circuit. Okay, so let's look at, this is the only technical slide I want to show, looking at the current that a transistor conducts as a function of that gate voltage, the control voltage. So it turns out that you have to apply a gate voltage higher than the threshold voltage to turn on the transistor to conduct current. And as you increase the gate voltage above the threshold, the current increases linearly, and this is a log scale. But below the threshold, the transistor doesn't actually turn off. It just, you see the current exponentially decrease, and so at 0 volts, there's still some non-zero leakage, IOF, leakage current. Okay, so what the industry has been doing is to lower gently the supply voltage, okay? And so therefore the on-state current, so the current that the transistor conducts when full voltage is applied, has decreased. And, but overall, you can improve the energy efficiency as long as the on-off current ratio doesn't degrade dramatically. But once the supply voltage goes below the threshold, the on-off current ratio, okay, let's go back. See, before here, this is the on current at high VDD. The on-off current ratio is pretty high, right? But as you lower the supply voltage, the on-off current ratio actually starts to degrade exponentially. And so if it degrades exponentially, then the total energy starts to grow up. So basically, it doesn't make sense to lower the operating voltage of a CMOS circuit below the threshold voltage. So clearly then, if we want to replace the MOSFET, we would like to have a switch that has higher on current to off current ratio for the same operating voltage. So we can have lower energy per operation, right? This E total is reduced if I on, I off is higher. And we can lower the supply voltage further before reaching that fundamental energy efficiency limit. Okay? So bottom line is we need a logic switch that switches on, more, on and off more steeply with increasing gate voltage. Okay, so that's why we arrived at the conclusion that a mechanical switch would be the best technology to, mechanical switch would be ideal to replace the transistor. Because if you have a physical gap between the source and the drain electrode, then you have no current. So in the off state, you have zero leakage, and so there's zero static power consumption. Now, how do we turn on this device? Well, we can apply a voltage to the gate, just like we do with a transistor, and that induces electrostatic force that tracks the source down towards the gate. And as long as this gap between the source and the gate is small compared to this actuation gap, then we'll have contact made only between the source and drain, not with the gate. And so current can increase abruptly once contact is made. And the current is limited by the resistance of this contact between the two metal materials. Now, when we lower the voltage back down, this structure is deformed, so there's going to be a spring restoring force. And we rely on the spring restoring force to counteract any contact adhesion to turn off this device. And that's why there's a little bit of hysteresis always in the switching behavior of a mechanical switch. So in principle, if we can minimize this hysteresis voltage and design the switch so that 0 volts is like right here, then the minimum voltage needed to operate a mechanical switch is just equal to that hysteresis voltage. And that can be very small. Researchers have published hysteresis voltages below 10 millivolts. So today, a transistor typically operates at closer to 1 volt. So if you lower the VDD, the supply voltage, from 1 volt to 10 millivolts, that's a factor of 100. But the power is, the active power is lowered by a factor of 10,000. Right, so we're talking about orders of magnitude reduction in energy per operation. So how do we make a mechanical switch? Well, it turns out that we can make mechanical switches using conventional techniques used to make integrated circuits. We can start with in cross-section, let's say a wafer substrate. So it's a cross-sectional view of a wafer. We deposit a thin layer of material that eventually will be removed selectively. So we call that a sacrificial layer. We can pattern it using conventional lithography and etch, just like integrated circuit layers today, and deposit a structural material that moves. And wherever the sacrificial material is removed, the structural layer is anchored to the substrate. We can pattern the structural material and selectively remove the sacrificial layer as a final step, and then we can have a movable membrane like this. Okay, so one criticism of mechanical switches is that they're not reliable as well. So not only are they big, slow, and so on, at least the old days, but not as reliable. So I just want to show some data looking at the number of cycles of switching, hot switching. So when you turn on the switch, it's conducting current, okay, it's hot switching, as a function of 1/ the supply voltage. So the voltage across the contacts when you bring them into or out of contact. So you can see this is an exponential scale. So ruthenium, this is this multiple data points, sorry, but let's just look at ruthenium, because ruthenium is a material that the industry likely is going to use in integrated circuits in the future. And so if you look at the number of cycles that a switch can turn on and off before welding shut, it increases exponentially as you lower the supply voltage to the right. So if we project down to operating, you know, at 1 volt or below, it's going to be, or let's say half a volt, it'll be on the order of 10 to the 16 cycles. Now, even for tungsten at 1 volt, you can achieve more than a quadrillion cycles. Okay, so we know that our relays can operate with much lower than 1 volt, so we know that endurance is adequate. So for Internet of Things applications, if you're sensing the room, maybe the temperature or the lighting and so on, or the occupancy, maybe your devices only need to be on for 1%, at the most, 1% of the time. Okay, and when your sensing device is on, maybe it's operating at 100 megahertz. So let's say a switch is operating, turning on and off at 100 megahertz when it's on. But it's on for only 1% of the time as in a sensor node. And you want it to last 10, 20 years. That's less than one quadrillion cycles. Okay, so for the Internet of Things, this kind of level of endurance is more than sufficient. And if you scale down to even 0.1 volts, which I'm going to show you that we can achieve, the endurance is longer than anybody's lifetime. Okay. Okay, so let me tell you one thing about designing integrated circuits for digital computing. It turns out that, yes, a mechanical switch operates, you know, turns on and off much more slowly than a transistor turns on and off. And for that reason, you'd want to design a circuit, a digital logic circuit using relays, quite differently than you would design a circuit. This is a NAND gate, and this is an inverter. This is the best way to implement a digital logic circuit with four inputs and one output for a certain function. For the same exact function, it's best to implement a relay circuit this way. Now, each of these gates has four transistors, if you remember, and each of these has two transistors. So a lot of transistors here, fewer relays to implement the same function. So it's not fair to compare a relay against a transistor. You need to compare a relay implemented integrated circuit block with a transistor implemented circuit block to make a fair comparison. Okay. And so we've actually, in the past, designed a lot of circuits and demonstrated a lot of integrated circuits implemented with relays using the proper, you know, optimal circuit topology. Anything up to adders, I think. Yeah. So we had basically A to D converters, D to A, digital to analog converters, and adders. And so from the experimental data, we developed a compact model to model the performance and energy and delay of a relay. So we anticipated if we scale the relay down to, let's say, 90 nanometer generation technology, what would the energy versus delay trade-off look like operating at, you know, less than a tenth of a volt? And compare that with 90 nanometer generation CMOS. You can see here that the CMOS bottoms out around here. We're talking about orders, you know, two orders of magnitude reduction in energy per operation by using relays. And if you look at the throughput, what Intel published a few years ago, operating a a CMOS chip near the threshold voltage, right? So with the VDD supply voltage near the threshold, they actually got this kind of speed and this kind of energy per operation. So you can see experimental data validating that our simulations are actually realistic in terms of predicting the energy efficiency limit of CMOS. Okay, so one final thing about designing a mechanical switch for computation. That simple three-terminal device, which turns on based on a voltage between the gate and the source, is not suitable for digital logic because in that pass gate topology, the source voltage can change to be high or low. So really, you need a fourth terminal, which we call a body terminal, that serves as a reference voltage to determine whether or not this switch is on or off. So basically, you can attach some source electrodes to this movable body to allow current to flow between the source and drain, and you can build multiple switches into one movable structure. But basically, the voltage on the source and drain does not affect the switching of this device. It is the voltage between the gate and the body that determines if the switch is on or off. And this is good for the pass gate logic style that I showed on the previous slide. So here at Berkeley, we fabricated such four-terminal or body-biased relays. Here's a cross-sectional view showing source and drain electrodes in plan views here. So source and drain electrodes, you have a bridge, so a metallic bridge in this schematic. When you apply voltage between the gate and the body, it actuates the body down, and this metallic bridge that's attached to the underside of the body basically allows current to flow between the source and drain. So you can see the gaps between the source and the channel and the drain in the channel are small compared to the actuation gap. Okay, so this is how it works. Looking in plan view, it's just a plate that moves up and down. The plate is suspended from the four corners by some suspension beams. They're folded like this so that we can account for thermal expansion and so on. So this switch operates over a wide range of temperatures, from liquid nitrogen temperature up to 200 degrees Celsius. Okay, so if we look at the measured current versus voltage characteristic, basically you can see it turns on and off very abruptly. This is with 0 volts on the body. But we can apply a voltage to the body, let's say negative voltage on the body, to really pre-actuate the structure down so there's less distance to go to turn on. So a lower gate voltage is needed to turn on the switch. So we can body bias it all the way down to be close to zero, as I mentioned earlier, to enable very low VDD operation. So we did this, and this curve just shows that with an input signal to the gate of only a tenth of a volt, we have an inverter circuit working properly, right? When the input is high, the output is low, and so on. Now, we can project that in the future, if we can scale the relay to be small, let's say a square micron in actuation area, the amount of energy needed to switch is less than 100 attojoules. And to put that into perspective, that's less than the energy needed to switch a transistor, an ultimately scaled transistor. Okay? So mechanical switches are promising not only because they have zero leakage, which is good for zero static power consumption, but actually even the active energy needed to operate them can be better than CMOS. Okay, so as the industry has advanced the transistor structures, like adopting the FinFET, they've also advanced the back end of line, the layers of interconnect materials that connect all of the transistors together on a chip to create a circuit. So if you zoom in on this very last image here from IBM, you can see that between these many layers of copper interconnect wires, there are air gaps. So there's actually air between metal wires here, and actually Intel revealed more than a year ago that its most advanced microprocessor chips have air gaps between the metal lines of various layers. And the reason for this is because as you have more and more transistors on a chip, the transistors are packed closer together. That means the wires have to come closer together, the wires that interconnect the transistors. But then the capacitive coupling between the wires goes up, and that's undesirable. So to reduce the capacitive coupling, they start putting air gaps in the chip. So a mechanical switch, what do you need to make a mechanical switch? Well, it's a conductive electrode, so you have lots of conductive electrodes here, and you need an air gap. Okay, so basically, our vision is that you can use conventional CMOS process technology with air-gapped interconnects to make mechanical switches right on top of CMOS at very low cost in the future. So here's a simulation of a back-end of line nano electromechanical switch, where you can use multiple layers of metal connected together with these electrical vias to form an actuator electrode on either side of a movable electrode. So in this design, you have an air gap between these blue electrodes, and it's depending on the voltage that you apply to that middle electrode, it can be either electrostatically actuated to the left or to the right. Okay, so you have two stable states. Contacting either, so the contact is only made up here, contacting either to the left or to the right. And from simulations, we know that because the industry is scaling the CMOS technology, making the metal lines really close together, these gaps will be very small, so we can operate this switch certainly with less than a volt, and the footprint can be very, very small. Okay? So it turns out that, well, it might be a mechanical switch might be slow compared to a CMOS transistor, but it's actually not bad compared to a flash memory device. Okay, so for your cameras, the storage memory cards, and for your thumb drives, now those memory devices, they actually it takes microseconds, let's say, to program or erase or flash memory cell. Also, from an energy standpoint, if you want to store information in a flash memory cell, even emerging memory technologies like resistive RAM or ferroelectric RAM. It takes a lot of energy to change the information stored in a flash memory cell or any of these emerging memory devices, because current has to flow in your transistor or has to flow in your resistor in order to change the state of the cell. But for a mechanical switch, no current has to flow. Okay, so if you look here, we could actually make these electrodes floating, not connected to anything, while the switching is occurring. We only need to apply voltage to this structure. So it's just capacitively charging or discharging this structure. No current has to flow to make it touch to the left or to the right. And for that reason, the amount of energy needed to operate a mechanical switch is much lower than a transistor, as I mentioned, but it's also orders of magnitude lower than any other non-volatile memory device. So if we engineer this, if we engineer a mechanical switch, this is the same kind of switch, but just skinnier, smaller layout, we can engineer the materials here, contacting to the left or to the right, engineer them to actually stick, to have the adhesive force stronger than the spring restoring force of this device. We can make a nice non-volatile memory device integrated right on top of CMOS with very, very small footprint. Okay, so this actually enables some interesting new circuit architectures. If you can integrate mechanical switches in a memory array, so rows and columns, with transistors. So here's one example that was published recently. So here's an array of four, four columns and four rows of memory cells. Each memory cell has a transistor connected to a mechanical switch. The switch has two stable states, either touching a DL1 electrode or a D0 electrode. Right? And the transistors can be used to access, apply voltage to the beams to get them to switch back and forth. Okay, so this is a 4x4 memory array. So let's say we store some information, 1100. That means that the first row is storing a 1, right? This beam is touching 1, data line 1. This second row, the beam is touching data line 1. Looking at the third row, this beam is touching the data line 0. And looking at the fourth row, the beam is touching data line 0. So this is how we store a 1100 in the first column. And similarly, different data strings are stored in the other columns. Okay, so in the Internet of Things, or in the future for information technology, a common function is to search for a pattern. Image recognition, pattern recognition, address recognition, and so on. So a very common function that information devices will need to perform in the future is to match a data string. So we can actually directly, the way this is usually done is you store the data in a memory chip, and then move one string at a time to a processor chip, and perform the comparison on the processor chip. And then you basically keep doing this, moving data back and forth between the memory chip and the processor chip until you find the location of the information that you're looking for on the memory chip. So that takes time and energy to move information back and forth. With an integrated NEM, nano-electromechanical memory, and CMOS technology, you skip that altogether. You can directly store information in the memory cell and directly find it in the memory array. So this is what we call in-memory computing example. So, for example, let's say you're looking for which column contains the data string 1100. So you can define this by just two simple steps. The first step is we call match zero. So we see that the third and the fourth digits should be zero. Okay, so basically we turn on all of the memory cells, or access all the memory cells in the third and the fourth rows, okay, corresponding to third and fourth position. Before doing that, we actually apply a voltage to the data one lines. Okay, so let's say a few tenths of a volt or a tenth of a volt, just putting a voltage on these data one lines. Then we access the rows that are supposed to have zero bits stored. And then we see if any current flows from these data line ones. The power is connected to a voltage. So here, it's connected, so current will flow out through this bit line. That means that this column doesn't have a zero stored there. Because if it has zero stored there, this beam would be connected here, and you wouldn't allow current to flow. Okay, so then we know that this column does not have data that matches the desired string. So you can see we can do the same thing, except now match ones. So here we look, okay, the first two positions, the digit positions, are supposed to store one. So we access the first two rows. But before doing that, we activate the DL0, the zero lines. And basically, if we see that, like here, we activate a DL0, this beam is touching. So current is going to flow here through this accessed second row. So we know that, okay, this position doesn't have a 1 stored. It has a 0 stored. So we know that it doesn't match. So with two simple steps, you can find which columns have the matching data. Okay, so it turns out that the time needed to detect if it's a match is just the time it takes to charge through the beam this bit line. So it's an RC delay. So we're talking about less than a nanosecond. So it's very quick. and the amount of energy needed to charge and discharge or discharge the RC, the capacitance of those lines is very small. So bottom line is you compare with the CPU plus DRAM. If you do this for a reasonably sized, like 8 gigabit array, memory array, this operation, the same data search operation, would take 90 millijoules, take 80 milliseconds. And here, if you do it directly with the hybrid MEMS CMOS technology, it takes orders of magnitude less energy, and the amount of time is on order of nanosecond. So it's faster, and it's much more energy efficient. So this is one example of how, if you can integrate mechanical switches with CMOS, you can actually achieve much greater energy efficiency. And actually, you don't even suffer in terms of performance. OK, so to summarize, bottom line is electronic devices in the future must be more energy efficient to realize the vision of swarms of electronic devices, the Internet of Things. Mechanical devices, I think, show promise, especially if we leverage integrated circuit technology, because we can make them very small, with low cost in the back end of line of a CMOS technology. The mechanical switches have zero off-state leakage. They can operate at very low voltage, lower than any transistor can operate with good on-off current ratio. Fabrication is relatively simple. You don't need any exotic semiconductor materials or dielectric materials, just air gaps and whatever metal is used in the back end of line anyway in a CMOS chip. And as I mentioned briefly, reliability of these switches is certainly adequate for Internet of Things applications. One thing, so what we're working on now is really being able to carefully engineer the stiction, contact adhesive forces, to make sure that we can achieve very reliable, non-volatile storage of information in those mechanical switches. So that's pretty much it. I just wanted to mention that, of course, all this work would not be possible without a lot of people who worked on this project over many years, professors here at Berkeley who we collaborated with postdoc, Professor Dr. Kato, and a senior student now as Chung, but there are many people that came before these people in my group, and also collaborators at other universities. And a lot of funding from different agencies over the years, and today this work is being supported by the National Science Foundation through the E3S Center. And finally, actually all of those relays that we showed, that I showed earlier, were fabricated here in the Marville Nanofabrication Lab here in the Sitar Jedi Hall. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'd be happy to answer any of your questions. You want to use this? I'm not sure that's, you might have to turn it on. The switch? Overhearing me?
The second slide.
Second slide? Oh, the search. This one. Oh, okay. Sure.
Oh, one more slide.
Here? Okay. Yeah, you're right. So this is the sneak path, leakage path.
Right.
Yeah, problem. Yeah, you're right. So actually, I'm not showing all the details, but basically what we assume in this contact, metal contact, actually will, in principle, there's always going to be some insulator, thin insulator. So basically, it'll act as a nonlinear device. What you need in this kind of a cross-point array is a so-called selector, a nonlinear device in series to make sure that sneak leakage paths don't flow. So in the actual paper that was published, we sort of presume that there will be built in, naturally, some device to prevent sneak leakage paths to flow, as Nathan mentioned. Yeah. Good question. There's another one here.
One of the energy sinks is communication.
Communication, yes. Yeah, so there has. Okay, so the question was, this one's actually working. So the question was, would these switches be good for switching RF signals? I mean, people have actually used, the companies have been developing RF MEMS switches to transmit RF signal. So you can have either capacitive coupled kind of a switch or direct, you know, direct current switch. Actually, to be honest, reliability is an issue for that application. You can't. There's a very limited number of cycles you can switch the these mechanical devices for that particular application. Yeah.
So is it size data compared to like a DRAM?
Ah, so the size. Let me just go to the end here. I have a backup slide. Oops. Yeah, sorry about that. So we actually have a slide to compare performance characteristics, including size, with other non-volatile memory devices, so NAND flash, phase change memory, resistive RAM, spin transfer torque, magnetic RAM, and this is the new one that we're talking about. But DRAM also is up there for comparison, even though it's not a non-volatile. But yes, so the question was the size. So the non-volatile memory is a little bit bigger than the DRAM. But you can see in terms of energy consumed, you have to refresh DRAM. This is non-volatile. So if what you care about most is energy efficiency, then I think the non-volatile memory should be a good option.
Okay. So is this a standard CMOS manufacturing process should work, right? Or is it require new?
Yes. So what we plan to, what we hope to do, there are some companies who have expressed interest now, is we do plan to adapt. So these upper layers of metal, basically, we expect that to be all the same as a conventional back end of line chip, like CMOS process. The only thing is we might want to engineer the materials in this topmost contact layer specifically. Here it doesn't matter because you're not making contact in the actuation portion of the structure. So yes, so at the most maybe one layer of metal would be added or specially engineered.
Okay, thank you.
Just curious, is there some metal fatigue with these switches? I mean,
fatigue?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, so that's a good question. So what we envision is that the actual amount of motion here is on the order of 10 nanometers. And if this beam is, you know, the stack of metal is on the order of a micron. So the amount of strain induced in the structure at the, you know, at the bottom is well below the fracture strain, you know, like 10 times below the fracture strain. So really, the failure mode always occurs in the contact. They tend to stick. But actually, if we take advantage of the fact that they tend to stick to make them non-volatile, then that problem ideally goes away. There's one more question over here.
I have one more. Okay. Is there a meaningful way to compare manufacturing cost to standard CMOS?
As I mentioned, as the industry has advanced CMOS technology, the point of Moore's law is as you advance the technology, you can make the transistors smaller. So for the approximate same number of steps, you can get twice as many transistors. Now, in reality, over the years, companies have had to add more layers of interconnect. So today, there are over a dozen layers of interconnect just to be able to interconnect all the transistors together. So over time, roughly the number of steps has stayed the same as we've increase the number of transistors, except we add maybe at the most one layer of metal. So this is the same kind of idea. You increase the functionality of your chip quite a bit, and the most you do is you add one more layer of metal. So it should be similar to, you know, to advance Moore's law. The cost should be.
So this is an incremental step to add mechanical operation to a CMOS process, right?
That's right.
So you do not envision a pure mechanical.
Okay, so a purely mechanical circuit, you could just implement like with our switches with a single metal layer. So that would be a much lower cost process. Yeah. But I think there are a lot of performance and energy efficiency gains if you combine CMOS with mechanics. So that looks pretty promising.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your questions.
Tsu-Jae.
All right.